No, remember that was the general rule is the certificate must be in time in possession of the and signed by the exporter. It must be in possession of the importer before or at the time making the preferential NAFTA claim. Now, when that's a general rule. So, and remember, I mentioned exceptions, and exceptions are pretty relatively narrow. So, what are they? Well, one of them deals with non-commercial importation, like personal effects, household effects. But it also can go for commercial imports as well. Origination statement is required for commercial imports. See that $2,500 rule? Remember that $2,500 rule is also associated with informal entry. So you have to provide a statement, right? So in a way, you kind of have, if you're making that statement, you kind of have to do your due diligence anyway. So you might as well just provide that certificate of origin. Statement must be signed by either the producer or exporter or agent, and statement must be attached to the documents. See, it must be signed by either producer, exporter, or importer, right? So this requirement is somewhat relaxed for $2,500 and under, because in a formal environment, in a formal, you have to make a formal entry. By the way, $2,500, even though it's a informal entry borderline, you can still, and sometimes you will have to make a formal entry. Of course, one reason to make informal is because you don't have to provide a bond; it liquidates on the spot. So you come to the closure right away. Formal entry, you have to spend more time with it. But usually NAFTA had big players in mind. They had commercial players in mind. So this is somewhat a narrow rule. So this is because it can be signed by the importer, right? Then it is kind of a relaxation, and it applies to that $2,500 rule. Now, I believe in a directive. In a directive, you have a statement, right, by customs. That says CBP does not require certificate for non-commercial importations or commercial importation of the total line item of 2,500 or less, right? And see, they make a point that it doesn't matter if the entry is formal or informal. For non-commercial imports, the value threshold is a little bit higher. I believe it's like $10,000. For commercial shipments, however, the invoice accompanying the importation shall include the statement. Remember, for non-commercial, it's easy. See that you just have to provide this, right? But for commercial, you have to have A, B, and C criteria. So you have to have certification, and CBP may require a certificate for the shipments if it is reasonably determined that a series of low-value importations was used instead of single importation to evade certificate requirements. So, in other words, this is to avoid the sneakiness, because you may break up the merchandise, break up the shipment into smaller parcels, so you don't have to comply and with the certificate, because certificate is burdensome or whatever other reason. Customs reserves the right to require CBP form 434 in any case. Now, here is something interesting about the waiver. Port director waives the requirement under NAFTA certificates of origin. Waiver made by the port director must be in writing. I want to take a step, sidestep for this particular topic, and make a point of how the regulatory environment changes as we speak. So let's go to that code of federal regulation that covers that poor director rule under the CFR. And of course, the NAFTA one would be 181. Specifically, we are looking at the section 181.22, maintenance of records. And if we are looking at the D, when certificate not required, right? We can kind of see there is this new concept being introduced. So we have a poor director. We are used to seeing poor director, and of course, when we see this word poor director, we are thinking about the concept of a CBP office located at a particular CBP port, and you have CBP officers, import specialists, entry specialists, field operations. They all act as delegates of the port director. They all act on port director's behalf within that particular port of entry. What has been happening for some time now is customs decided to move away from port-centric model and is to transition to what's called center-centric model. And as a result of that, you when you look at the regulations, you will see that throughout, and you will see this with time, not very long time, I believe from now, you will also see that trickling in into the licensed customs broker exam. If you pay close attention, for example, here you see another one, center director, right? See, you have the center director here. So what is that center, what is that center stuff that customs is talking about in the regulation, in the in its phraseology? This is something which I wanted to draw your attention to. So, center, customs is referring to what's known as centers of excellence and expertise. So, when customs for its long history, customs has been using ports as a main for point of enforcement. In the name of efficiency, in the name of you may even call it of 21st century, you have customs moving away from the port-centric model to the center-centric model. And what customs mean by center of excellence and expertise is they have, throughout the nation, they created certain focus points. And within those focus points, they created they created a body of experts. And by the way, those body of experts, which are located, for example, which operate out of San Francisco, do not even have to be located in San Francisco. They just communicate, associate, and report to anywhere from San Francisco. So you may have an apparel expert in Laredo, which reports to the Center of Excellence and Expertise in San Francisco, right? But nevertheless, in the name of efficiency, customs created these centers of expertise. And if there is a question, if there is a issue, it is usually dealt with that particular center. So in San Francisco, you have apparel, footwear, textiles. LA, you have electronics, Laredo machinery. Houston, of course, petroleum, natural gas. It's Texas, right? Miami, you have agriculture. Atlanta, you have consumer goods, so stuff you find in a general merchandise for a store like Walmart. Chicago, you have base metals. Detroit, you have autos, because it used to be a center for automotive industry. Buffalo, it's industrial manufacturing materials. And New York, pharmaceuticals, health, and chemicals. So the pharma industry, biotech industry, this stuff. So this is where it comes from. And customs has promulgated several regulations where there is a shared authority. So let's say you file a protest in Miami, but it relates to the biotech sector, it may be forwarded to the New York, and someone in New York, or at least on behalf of New York Center of Excellence and Expertise, will be deciding this particular issue in question. So, and before you used to have various specialists, import specialists usually, in various ports of entry, and they had to be so-called mini experts. So customs said, all right, let's specialize, let's have one person specialize in one particular product and just know a lot about this. So in a way, it makes sense. In a way, it makes sense because in my experience, I found myself dealing with people who were not very familiar with a particular area. For example, I dealt with chemicals, and I was working on a chemical project, and I was trying to persuade customs at the particular port to adopt a certain posture. And when I provided and I must admit, I'm not that good in chemistry, but I had a assistance of the PhD in chemistry, and so I provided the legal part, the PhD provided the chemical part, the scientific part, and when we presented a memorandum of law, the CBP officer was like, oh wait, this is too much, so they sent it over to headquarters through the internal advice. Now they may not have to go to headquarters, which was main brain located, and I believe still located, but they may send it to New York, let's say. So that's the point. More on Centers of Excellence Expertise, use this link to find out more. But when you show up to the exam, if you see this center director, center of excellence expertise, do not be afraid that this is some kind of new weird creature. It is new. Probably it is not so weird. It is a logical extension of efficiency optimization rubric, which customs took aboard at this time. Whether it is more efficient or not, I think it's too early to tell. Well, we'll have to wait and see. But the idea makes sense, at least in the modern age of communication. So that's where this stuff comes from. All right. So let's see. So poor director, now you can say the center director, waives the requirement for NAFTA certificate of origin. Waiver made by the poor director must be in writing. For me, actually, this is a big headache because I will now have to place poor director or center director in a lot of stuff, so in a lot of outlines. So, but it's okay. In due time, things will come. Once I made the side step, we kind of safe proof from the centers of excellence and expertise vantage point. All right. So, when claiming North America Free Trade Agreement NAFTA, a certificate of origin is required to be in possession, right? At the time of preferential treatment, notice before or at, so it can kind of interchangeable. When it is not requirement, well, the shipment has a total value over, to notice it's must be equal to or less than $2,500. If it's over, no good. Port director waives the requirement. Well, hold on a second. It can be over, but it must be personal, right? The port director waives the requirement. So the waiver is another criteria, right? The merchandise, so this is possible, right? But that $2,500 just sticks out, right? So what's to conclude? Once you kind of like looking at the methodology, what's to conclude? Well, non-commercial shipment, if customs examiners will be testing your non-commercial shipments, and notice, in when I was preparing this outline, I couldn't find any specific tests on non-commercial shipment. It can be mentioned in the passage. If I would find one, I would stick one quiz break right in there, but I couldn't find one that directly deals with it. So it is likely that it is not of huge concern to customs, right? So if you see that 2500 and you see the exception, customs is likely not testing you or not picking your brain on non-commercial import exception. So the shipment has a total value over 2500. Provided that it is commercial, then this is the certificate of origin is required. The port director waives the requirement. Yes, this is one of the criteria under the regulations. Customs examiners may now say the center director. The merchandise is textiles, electronics, or pharmaceutical goods. Well, remember the criteria: non-commercial, value-based, 2500 if commercial, with plus statement, or waiver by the port director. The merchandise is originating. Well, originating what? Under NAFTA? Okay. That's not on the criteria of the list, right? E, a post-NAFTA claim is filed under 19 U.C. 1520D. 19 U.C. 1520D, a post North American Free Trade Agreement claim. When you file this, you need to provide that certificate of origin. Obviously, the reason that you filed it is because you didn't claim NAFTA preference at the time of entry. So, seeking a waiver is not really relevant because you availed yourself of that procedure. So, this is something which doesn't make sense under this fact pattern. So E is an outlier. Here, the waiver one is right on point, making B a correct answer choice.